Well, good evening, everyone, and it is Friday, September 1st.
Wow. Oh, my God. Yeah. What has happened to the time? How did it get to be September 2023?
And it's just like the summer flew by, and I'm already harvesting and canning. Remember last year, you were here in September helping me harvest.
I was.
Yeah. Well, hi, everybody, and welcome to our show tonight. And we do have a, we have a good show. We have quite a good show. And I'm going to let Jennifer give a little bit of a 20,000 foot overview of the show. And so, Jen, take it away and tell us how you are and what's been going on.
All right. So, guys, the big article we have going on today is called The Points of No Return by Grist. And very, very interesting. It's a big one. It's very beautiful. It's kind of high tech and it's got a lot of good information. So that's probably where we're going to spend a lot of our time. Also, Sandy has created a great slideshow as usual.
It's comedy night.
Is it?
Yeah.
Good. And we're going to take a look at a new offering by an author. Some of you may know Peter Russell, and this is called Forgiving Humanity, How the Most Innovated Species Became the Most Dangerous, The Curse of Exponential Change. So we'll just kind of tell you about this. I listened to it today on Audible. And then, as promised, because I know Void was one of the people who was so interested in this, an article from the New York Times, Worms Revived After 46,000 Years Frozen in Siberian Permafrost.
Yes.
Scientists want to understand how the worms survived in extreme conditions for extraordinarily long periods of time, like 46,000 years. And no, guys, not only did they find these worms, bring them back to life, but then they bred them and they bred and they had progeny. It's the most holy shit. You
bread? Know? Did they have tomatoes and mayonnaise?
Yeah, exactly. Wow. And that is pretty much it. I think that with, you know, the slideshow that you got, Sandy, that's probably enough.
Well, we're pretty busy, so I'm going to get started. I'm going to get the reading overlay. Here we go. All right, so welcome tonight to The Point of No Return. Now, I don't know if you guys remember, it's a band called Kansas. And they were from the 1970s. And
Sure.
Yeah. So I got a little inspired. And that was their record album, actually. And back in the day, you know, those of us that are old enough that had record albums, well, and a lot of people do, you know, have them. But this was the cover. Of course, I edited it, but this was the cover. And anyway. Are we at a point of no return? We don't know for sure. But anyway, I'm going to go on. I know, right, Jen? We could say we are so, you know, whatever. But let's work on this. So now I'm just going to go to this first one because, you know, we always talk about anomalies and we talk about all this stuff. So tonight, we're bringing you this, and it is the temperature anomaly refers to the departure of the current day's forecast temperature from a long-term mean for the same day of the year. And, you know, it's scientific. A lot of you maybe you don't know what it all is. And so I thought, okay, I could tell you find the sum of the values by adding them all up, divide the sum by the number of values of the data set. That's the mean. Or we could look at the standard deviation and do all the statistics. Or, you know.
Or. As something easier than that.
Yes. And he's easy. Good. And we have someone that I found. I don't know if you guys are, but this does look ominous, doesn't it? But it is. It's all the temperature differences on a standard deviation. It's cool. But It's a bit of a, it is video night. You know, it's teaching night. It's video night. This guy's awesome. I like him. And the best part is he debunks the assholes I can't stand. So I just found him. I don't have to do it. He's Yay. Doing it. All right. So this is him. Roshan Salgado Darce, or Roche. He's a PhD researcher studying the communication of climate change in modern media, and he has formal training in earth and climate science. He has a BS in geology and an MS in climate change. So we're going to listen to him teach us. Now, it's a little, you know, I mean, some of these are a little longer, but I want you guys to learn. Even if you know what the anomaly is, some of you maybe don't understand it. And he's going to explain it.
Since the dawn of humanity, mankind has been obsessed with measuring things. The distance between cities, the length of a river, the size of mountains, and many other things. Climate change is no different, but how do we measure it? After all, climate is the long-term average of weather, so it operates over long timescales and large geographic areas. It's not exactly easy to quantify. But if we want to approach it scientifically, then measure it we must. So how do we do it? Well, it makes sense to start by measuring weather. Wind speed, air pressure, rainfall, and humidity are all measurable, and weather stations all over the world do just this. But ultimately, all changes in climate, whether it's rainfall patterns or humidity levels, are driven first by changes in air temperature. So it is temperature which climate scientists tend to focus on. And when it comes to measuring global climate change, we need to measure changes in global temperature. So how do we do this? We can't just jam a thermometer into the planet. That would be expensive, impractical, and ineffective, not unlike taking horse drugs to prevent COVID. And then there's the fact that the planet's temperature varies depending on where you are. The poles are colder than the tropics, the troposphere is warmer than the stratosphere, and the Earth's core is hotter than everything else combined, except maybe Jeff Goldblum. Anyway, scientists are normally most concerned with the air temperature at the planet's surface. After all, that's the bit where we live. But even so, the temperature of this part of the atmosphere can still be highly variable, even over small areas. The difference in temperature between a town and the surrounding countryside, for example, can be several degrees. This makes calculating the exact surface temperature of the whole planet exceptionally difficult. To do that, we would have to take the average of thermometer readings for almost every square mile of the entire planet's surface. And given that 70% of it is ocean, and significant areas of the remaining 30% are either uninhabited, inaccessible, or desolate, it is simply not possible to measure the exact temperature of the planet's surface with a high degree of accuracy. For reference, our best estimate is in the region of 15 degrees Celsius. But for the purposes of measuring climate change, when even slight changes of a few fractions of a degree matter, we would need a much more precise measurement than we can currently get. Now, I know what some of you are thinking, but Roche, what about all those graphs showing how global temperatures have risen over the last 100 years? If we can't measure the exact surface temperature of the planet, then what are they all about? Well, if you look closely, you'll see that these graphs aren't showing the actual temperature of the planet. They're showing temperature anomalies, which are defined as the difference between the temperature being measured and a reference baseline temperature. For example, if the average temperature of Gotham City was 15 degrees between the years 1900 and 1950, and this year it averaged 16 degrees, then the temperature anomaly would be plus 1 degree relative to the baseline period. Now, the main advantage of using anomalies rather than absolute temperature is that anomalies tend to be constant over large areas, even if the absolute temperatures within that area vary considerably. So if it's a degree warmer than normal in Gotham City, then the chances are it's a degree warmer than normal in the surrounding countryside, even if the absolute temperatures are quite different. This means that you don't need as many data points from around the world to build a global picture, though preferably your data wouldn't come from fictional cities. The other advantage of using anomalies is that we don't need to know the exact temperature of the planet in order to measure global temperature change. As long as the reference period is the same, we can take the average of anomalies from all over the world in order to calculate the global anomaly. And when we plot global anomalies through time, we can clearly observe a positive trend, which indicates that the planet is warming. The size of the anomaly also tells us how much warming has occurred compared to whatever arbitrary baseline we're using. This graph, for example, tells us that 2020 was, on average, a degree warmer than the 1951 to 1980 average. So that's why we use temperature anomalies rather than absolute temperature. But how do we go about collecting this data in the first place? Well, there are two key methods. The first involves collecting measurements from various weather stations around the planet, and these data are collectively known as the instrumental or surface thermometer record. The second, less accurate method, is via satellite. Now, unlike Jeff Goldblum, who is perfect in every way, both of these methods have limitations. A common criticism of the instrumental record, for example, is that the type of thermometer, the station location, or the environments around the stations can sometimes change, and these changes can artificially distort the data. This means that scientists must make adjustments to correct for them, something which climate contrarians love to claim is part of an insidious plot to usher in a new world order, or whatever it is they think is the end goal of their supposed climate conspiracy. Personally, I'm... what's the word? Skeptical. Anyway, despite accounting for these issues, there will always be a margin of error around the data, and this is why temperature graphs often have error bars on the trend line. This indicates that the actual temperature anomaly could fall anywhere within the highlighted area. Satellite data also has limitations. For one thing, it only goes back as far as the 80s. No! It also has to be adjusted for something called orbital drift, which can artificially introduce trends into the data. Additionally, satellites don't actually measure surface temperature. Instead, they measure the average temperature of the lowest 8 kilometers or 5 miles of the atmosphere, which is like pretty high. Again, this is where temperature anomalies become useful, because although the exact temperature of such a large chunk of the atmosphere will be quite different from the temperature measured down here, the temperature changes, the anomalies, should track the changes at the surface. And although both the surface and satellite records are imperfect, we can improve our confidence in them by comparing them to each other. And when we do that, they line up pretty well. Sure, it's not perfect, but it's pretty good. So those are the two methods we have for measuring temperature change on the planet, and they both pretty clearly indicate that the Earth is warming. But maybe you're still not convinced. Well, fortunately, there are several other indicators that we can use to infer global temperature trends, and again, by combining them together, we can increase our confidence in the conclusion that the planet is getting warmer. These are the amount of ice on the planet, the heat content of the oceans, and sea levels. In all cases, the trend is clear. The planet's glaciers, sea ice, and ice caps are all in decline, ocean temperatures are rapidly rising, and the rate of sea level rise is increasing. In short, it is absolutely unequivocal that the planet is getting warmer. Now, why it's warming, how this warming compares to the rest of Earth's history, and whether it's a coincidence that the hottest decades on record happen to have coincided with Jeff Goldblum's existence, are all topics for future videos. So if you want to see those, then make sure to subscribe and hit the bell icon to be notified whenever I upload. Thanks for watching, and until next time, goodbye.
Wow.
I found
guy was like so animated.
I found his channel just today, and I've been watching his debunking videos, and oh my gosh, he gets every troll on the planet in his comment sections on his debunking videos, but I find him to be entertaining, and I thought it was good. And did you guys, you know, that maybe didn't know about anomalies, how he explained it? I thought it was good.
I thought that was so interesting to see the average anomaly graph and going up year upon year upon year. It was like, okay, that explains it right there. Look at that global anomaly map.
Right. And here's an anomaly map right here. 30-year
baseline.
Here's Elliot's again. Every week we do Elliot's.
Oh, dear. So it's getting here. It hasn't gone down yet. It's still bad.
Nope. It's still an anomaly.
Global sea surface temperature anomaly.
Jed says, Jed, I will get the guy's name for you. His name is Rosh, and we'll be showing you his channel, so hang on.
He cracks me up.
Yeah.
He really cracks me up.
Yeah. And so here we go with sea temperature, and it's hot. It's hot. And I want to say, you know, of course, we know we had the hurricane in Florida this week, and we're not going to talk about that too much because I had to deal with worrying about my mom again, 89-year-old mom down there again, who sat in her closet last year through Ian. So this was better for her, but everybody else is talking about it, so we don't have to.
No.
Okay. So next, we've got some scientists' rebellion here, and this is really good. I mean, I couldn't have done this better myself. That was pretty good. I mean, I would make something like that, you know? It was dark. Scientist Rebellion. It was kind of dark. Yeah. Like it's like my thinking can be dark in my videos. Those of you who watch my videos. All right. So, Jen, here we move on to Scott Duncan. And he's talking about the Southern Hemisphere. Look at this. Perth Airport in Western Australia just recorded its hottest winter day on record, which goes back 79 years there. Cape Town in South Africa records its hottest day on record. Records go back 63. So look at the weather. What do you have to say about that, Ms. Jen?
Well, you know, it's the middle of winter in the Southern Hemisphere, and even you can see over there South America, you know, the right-hand map there.
South
you've
Africa?
Got South America. Well, South Africa's there, but if you go over just there, you can see South America. It's
right
there.
Right there.
No.
Oh,
the other way.
My thing showing? Oh, here. What am I looking
there
at?
There. I've got that's South America.
15 screens open.
Anomalously hot. Yeah, it was on the same picture.
Yeah, there it is.
And everything is hot. Looks like Africa's really picking up and... Yeah, that's pretty tough temperature for Cape Town in the middle of winter, huh? Whoa, ho, ho.
Whoa,
oh, what's
ho,
that
ho
big white thing at the bottom of the picture? That must be Antarctica.
Yeah.
Melting fast on a planet near you.
The melting paradise. Yes. The melting paradise where the penguins could not, we lost all those penguin chicks and we couldn't do the show on it. Or I don't want to cry, so we're not going to talk about the penguin chicks. Nope, we're not going to cry tonight. We're going to laugh.
This is what I think the best part about where we are in history is. We missed the deadline on reversing climate change, so now we can just relax and have fun. You know what I mean? It's like, it's too late. We can't do anything. What? We tried. Oh, well, you know. But we can still go outside without our skin blistering, you know? So it's like... I think the government knows it's too late. That's why they start legalizing marijuana everywhere. They're like, here's your end-of-life drug. Take your gummy. It won't be long now. I took mine. No, I was looking at Reddit. I saw a picture of Greta Thunberg littering. I was like, oh, shit. This goes all the way to the top, man. I'm back on plastic. I'm using straws again. I take my garbage, I put it directly into the ocean. I go, be with your friends. Go live your truth.
Yeah, I thought that was pretty good. I say the same thing. They're legalizing everything, like, you know, weed, so that we can... just like anesthetize ourselves because they know. Sounds like a conspiracy, doesn't it? They know. Did you like that, Jen?
Yes, I did. Yeah. It was so funny. He got such good stuff.
And here is, which you can talk about, the sea ice extent.
Right. So this is the Arctic sea ice extent.
From Professor Jacobson.
Oh, yes. Okay, from Professor Jacobson, and we are the white line, almost down at the bottom. So we are not the lowest we've ever been. That's good. We are well below the mean, but the minimum it's ever been is the red line. So we're still within that, which is good.
No blue ocean event this year.
No, thank goodness.
Mm-mm. Nope.
Another year.
Ooh. Another year.
We can all buy. Right.
And here we move on to our little bit of entertainment tonight.
Certainly it's been ending environmentally for a long time, and we've all kind of known it. We knew it. But I think on a deeper level, the reason we're not more upset about the world ending environmentally is I think you know, all of us in our hearts really know that we did everything we could. You know, we really, right? I mean, we really did. I mean, think about it. We, you know, we brought our own bags to the supermarket. And it's crazy, man. We just kind of live with it. And they're worse and worse. And, you know, like you get those panicky calls from friends and relatives on the East Coast. Like my mother will call from Florida. Hi, are you okay? Yeah? What are you talking about? The fires. Oh, shit. Yeah, they're not by me. Did they say where they are on the news where you are? Where? Oh, shit, that is kind of by me. Hold on a second. I'm going to take a look out my front door here. Oh, shit, Ma, I got to call you back. I can see the fires. They're like right here. Yeah, I got to call you back. I got to get a selfie with these fires.
He was pretty good.
Oh, God, you guys, buddy.
Mark Maron. And then we're going to move. We're going to move to Jeff Baradelli, meteorologist extraordinaire, who Antonio interviewed years ago on our channel.
Oh, great.
And this is my, you know, the contribution to the hurricane section. Okay. So 8 major hurricanes in 7 years. And he's making the point, you know, that this is sort of, is this an anomaly? It's not usual. 8 in 7 years. So wanted to show that. And then we've got another little piece for you because it is hurricane section. Hurricanes. And now, is this a comedy act? Let me ask you guys.
I find it so interesting to watch the preparation by Governor Ron DeSantis and the need to have linemen available with trucks with diesel fuel and generators with natural gas to prepare for a hurricane, which is completely the opposite of what the climate agenda calls for.
Right. It's the opposite of what we saw in Maui. I mean, you know, they were not releasing the water. In fact, they didn't have a plan to shut down the power lines when there was brush on the ground. But what's so fascinating about this is one of the first hurricanes reported was, I think it was in the 1400s. Now, I would venture a guess that had nothing to do with fossil fuels. Okay. But they're certainly convinced that we've got something to do with all of this. And then the other issue is, you know, wildfire season. Oh, it's terrible. It's because it's man-made, the wildfire. It's because of climate change. But I mean to say it's man-made. It's really about arson. It's about poor forest management. It's about making sure or not making sure that the brush that's on the ground, it ends up meeting a power line. I mean, all of this stuff can be handled if we at least recognize, as Ron DeSantis is recognizing, that you can prepare for it, you can plan ahead, and you can be ahead of the game. But all of these claims that hurricanes and wildfires are the result of climate change and the hot weather happens in the summer. I mean, that's just the way it is.
I can't stand them. And you know what? It's like I always say when I see the trolls or I listen to these people, I'm like, they're the reason why humanity will go extinct. I'm telling you, Jennifer.
You know, I mean, you would think that if you're going to go ahead and deny everything, you would take a good hard look at it for something that's as important as the life of the planet and the life on Earth here. You would think if you're going to go ahead and deny that, you take your level best shot to understand what the hell's going on.
But they
don't.
Not
like these crazy people.
No, they're all, and you know, they're anti-science. And they went to law school, some of them. Anyway, so I had sent this meme. This was funny. I sent this meme to my mom and she didn't get it at first. And I said, Mom, you really have to look closer. Jen, can you read it?
Yeah. The weather has been changing for all of history, but the scientists don't tell you that. How would they even know it's hotter now? They couldn't measure the temperature back then.
Look at the floor.
God.
He's a fucking flooded.
It's always changing.
Yeah, it's always changing. Climate always changes. That's why I say.
Break me out another beer.
Yeah, while my house is flooding from a catastrophe. God. So, you know, and that's why I'm not using climate change anymore. I'm using global warming, which it is, because I'm not going to pay homage to Frank Luntz, the market media guy for the Republican Party that changed it so that it wouldn't sound scary or ominous. And so it's global warming. I think everybody should change it. So this is a good one. It's not a fun one.
Yeah,
the Coral Reef Watch, NASA, NOAA, the National Oceanic.
So these are the actual water temperatures, not any anomalous heat. This is actual heat. And as you guys can see, the purple, the dark purple, the deep purple, and look at that tip of Florida, that deepest, deepest purple. It's almost black, right? Right off the tip there, going down the Keys. Oh, well, you know, it's going to fry all of the coral reefs. It just is. So
well,
this is the coral reef watch as the coral fries, you know, very, very, very sad.
It is. And actually, I was watching the Florida station that Jeff Baradelli is on, and he was talking about it. And but, you know, he can't talk about everything he wants on the channel. Even though he became a climate scientist, but he does a good job on Twitter. So that's a good one. But the corals, you know, RIP coral.
It's really sad.
Because Florida, you know, Florida's screwed. So here we go. This is Leon. And Leon, global surface air temperatures are shocking. June to August was extremely hot. It broke last year's record by 0.3 C. But this wasn't the El Nino effect many say it is yet. So down there, this is Leon Simmons, our buddy on Twitter. And so he's showing, can you see it, Jen, how he shows the 215, the 216, the 223 is just getting started and where it is in degrees?
Yeah, that's right. You can see that the El Niños have the peaks. So we're looking at the peaks and the valleys. The peaks are the El Niños, the valleys are the La Niñas. And you can see 98 was a super El Nino. 2015, it was the start of a super El Nino that crested in 2016. And now we are just starting to crest into El Nino 2023, and we're already off the charts.
Yeah. So there we are. And Leon, you know, thank you for the data, Leon. We're gonna move on. And now comes industrialized civilization.
Hi there. Justine Johnson here, CEO of Builders Manufacturing Limited, and I'm here to talk to you about the future of builders. Times have changed. We're dealing with a different landscape than our parents before us. For 70 years, Builders has been on the front line of progress and innovation, and we want to continue that trend going forward. Builders Manufacturing Limited is committed to fighting climate change, and we are dead set in moving toward a greener tomorrow. Let us show you how. Builders has invested literally tens of dollars in the latest carbon capture technology.
What do I do now?
I don't know, just get rid of it.
Like open the bag?
No, because then it won't be captured.
Well, I can put it in the garbage.
Just get rid of it.
It's
slippery. Builders Manufacturing Limited, we have an entire department dedicated to reducing our carbon footprint. In the cafeteria, all the food that we provide is plant-based. We're also mailing every piece of ice back to the ice caps to restore them to their natural glory.
Oh my God!
And lastly, we're looking at renewable energy sources to help power our plants. You ever heard of wind energy? What if I told you that each and every one of us is a wind energy source? Kind of like that. We're putting a lot of dollars into this research, and we've hired a specialist named Candy, who I believe is an expert in blowing, so I have heard. She comes with great references. Oh, Candy's, she's not working? She's not a blowing specialist? Oh, she is. Oh, it's just a different kind of blowing. Okay, so she's on this project? She is, okay. So she's working on this project, but it's in another capacity. Well, there you have it. Builders Manufacturing Limited, the name you've grown to know and love from our family to yours. We're making a difference together for a greener future.
Oh. Brought to you by capitalism.
Oh my God, that was funny.
Yeah.
That was funny.
So everybody's got a channel I put their names on, and it should be good, but all right. So now that you've been entertained tonight, we're going to go, and of course, we're going to Bummerville. Kevin Anderson, who's amazing. I have to be honest and say, as someone who has worked on climate change for years, my best guess is that we're going to fail, but it's a choice to fail. Political leaders, academia, and journalism have repeatedly chosen to fail on climate for 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Kevin. Well, we're coming to the end of the slideshow. And with that, the point of no return.
Awesome.
All right.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. How long to the point of no return? That's what it was. So really quickly, before we dive into everything tonight, I want to show you on Twitter. This is called The Science World. And if you see the background behind me and Jennifer, it came from this channel. And I really wanted to make sure I did an attribution because I had forgotten. But here it is.
Oh, wow. Yeah. That's cool, Andy. Yeah.
And they're pretty brand new on Twitter. And so, I mean, they've only got 126 followers. So, of course, I wanted to, you know, I wouldn't just want to take it because I could do that, use Storyblock, you know. So, that's that. And so let's go over to the next one. Jen, you take this, and you wanted to talk about this because it's really important.
Well, you know, I don't know about you guys, but I've been watching for days and days this typhoon, and I believe it's called Typhoon Sayola. Mm-hmm. It has been hanging out in that South China Sea, and I was watching it as it went through the strait between Taiwan and the Philippines, and it kind of clipped Taiwan, and then it got into that, whatever that sea is, and right before China.
Oops.
Yeah, and it just hung there and just kind of ground and ground and ground. But it's a super typhoon. It Hong Kong did get a direct hit today. The eye of the hurricane went directly over the city. I haven't seen what's happened to the city itself, but I'll just read a couple of little paragraphs here so we can just kind of acknowledge it, because everyone's been talking about the Florida hurricane or whatever, but this one was actually a historic.
Look at this, Jennifer. Just look what happened to this girl in look at this.
Oh,
yes. That's right from that.
Oh my God. Is that fake or is that real?
That's real. That's what happened. So I gotta turn it off. But so that was from Disaster News.
Okay.
So we start off with some real blowing.
Yeah. Yep. So I'm just going to read the first paragraph so we get a kind of flavor for it. The historic Typhoon Sayola gave Hong Kong a tremendous pounding Friday. Today evening local time as the ferocious 130-mile-an-hour sustained winds of its northern eyewall raked the city. Sayola, which is named after the world's rarest large mammals, a forest-dwelling bovine, native to the Annamite Range in Vientiane, in Vietnam and Laos. Oh, I know what that creature is. triggered the issuance of a rare Signal 10 advisory for Hong Kong from the Hong Kong Observatory, reserved for the most extreme storms for the first time since 2018. And my God, what a big storm it was. It was a perfect hurricane. Just look at that. Sandy, the second video, you can play that one from Colin McCarthy. It kind of shows you how it progressed along. That's a pretty interesting, yeah, that one there. So amazing that these things are happening all over the place. So it came, it went, and I haven't really heard too much about what's happened to Hong Kong. But
I don't know.
The eye of the hurricane went directly over the city of Hong Kong.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
All right. We'll find out. If anybody has a link or finds anything out, just let us know, because we didn't catch up with it.
It says that Hong Kong is not especially to storm surge since it has few low-lying areas. It's all mountainous.
All right.
However, let's hope. Guangzhou, China, with a metro area population of 25 million is in the strong right front quadrant of the typhoon, and that city, which has 25 million people, may experience significant storm surge. So there you go.
Wow. All right. Well, I'm going to take you a little bit different, because you guys were asking about all about climate, about Rosh. This is his page. This is his, and this is what he does. And he debunks, and I like it. This was really good. The fact checking Candace Owen. Yeah. I haven't watched them all. It's not an old channel. He only doesn't have a lot of videos, but they're really well done. And it's interesting. So there, I like to turn people on to other people who are really good. All right. So, Jen, are we ready to go into our big story?
Yes, we are.
All right. Yes, it's tipping points time. And this is why the show is called Point of No Return.
Right.
Sea, ice, and land. And I will let Jennifer take over the helm.
Okay. So we start off on sea. Is that right, Sandy?
Yeah.
Start on sea. Okay, so as the world warms, these Earth systems are changing. Could further warming make them spiral out of control? In 2019, an international team of scientists published a commentary in the celebrated science journal Nature, sounding the alarm of a planet in crisis and calling for transformative change. We are in a state of planetary emergency. Mm-hmm. The stability and resilience of our planet is in peril. Yes, they were writing about climate change, but of a particular kind, climate tipping points, elements of the Earth system in which small changes in global temperatures kick off reinforcing loops that tip a system into a profoundly different state, accelerating heat waves, permafrost thaw, coastal flooding, and in some cases, fueling more warming. The planet has already warmed by roughly 1.2 degrees Celsius, 2.2 Fahrenheit, since the Industrial Revolution. And if humans keep flooding the atmosphere with greenhouse gases at the same rate, we're on track to increase that to 2.7 to 3.1 degrees C, which is 4.9 to 5.6 Fahrenheit by the end of the century. And I think that's really conservative. So those small changes are getting bigger, increasing the likelihood of triggering those reinforcing loops known as positive feedbacks. For example, warming increases the frequency of wildfires, which in turn increase the amount of carbon dioxide released into the atmosphere from burning trees, which leads to an increase in global temperature, which means, you guessed it, even more wildfires. So, scientists identified various elements of Earth's system at the risk of reaching points of no return. These elements broadly fall into three categories: ice, sea, and land, and range from the melting of the Greenland ice sheet to the death of coral reefs and the raging of more and more wildfires. My goodness. And look at this map. You can see right away everything blue is sea tipping points. Everything kind of aqua is ice tipping points, and everything kind of sandy is land tipping points.
You know, this article has really brought together several weeks of our show.
It has.
Really is. It's bringing it together.
Yeah. The concept of tipping points challenges the dominant understanding of how climate change fundamentally works, says Will Steffen, one of Nature's article's co-authors and an emeritus professor of climate science at Australian National University. Rather than a dial slowly turning up, tipping points could compound, he says, combining to build a greater planetary-wide tipping point. Alternatively, they could push one element out of whack, triggering another to fall out of phase, and then another in a domino-like effect, resulting in rapid acceleration of warming until Earth stabilizes in another state. These possibilities are far from certain, he admits, but the consequences of planetary tipping points are severe enough that even a slim risk needs to be taken seriously. The particular danger, according to Nature paper authors, is that even though change in tipping element may happen slowly on a human time scale, once a certain threshold in the system is crossed, it can become unstoppable. This means that even if the planet's temperature is stabilized, the transition of certain Earth systems from one state to another could pick up speed, like a roller coaster car that's already gone over the apex of a track. Jacqueline Gill, a paleoecologist at University of Maine, who studies physical records of the Earth's ancient climate, she didn't work on the Nature paper, but she says that the evidence from Earth's history supports the idea of non-linear climate responses. And that understanding, this evidence can help us to get a better understanding of what may lie ahead. It's not just a matter of more CO2 equals more warming, Gill says. There will be feedbacks. For Steffen and his co-authors, including Tim Lenton, the director of the University of Exeter's Global Systems Institute, understanding the risk of tipping points requires a radical reframing of the climate challenge, a more fundamental shift in human society than merely pumping successively fewer and fewer emissions into the atmosphere. Quote, we're right about the tipping point, we're not marginal, Lenton tells Grist. There, existential risks. Do you want to take one, Sandy?
Sure. Okay, so look at that. Beautiful graphics.
Beautiful.
Very beautiful. And that's the Atlantic Ocean approaching Western France in the Bay of Biscay. Look at that. Beautiful. When it comes to the climate crisis, the sea is both an unwitting ally and a frequent victim. The world's five oceans, which cover 70% of its surface, absorb heat and carbon dioxide, gobbling up at least a quarter of the emissions dumped into the air from the burning of oil, gas, and coal. Without them, the world would have already warmed so much it would be virtually uninhabitable by humans. But all the absorption comes at a cost. As heat rises, ice melts, carbon dioxide pours into the ocean, ecosystems are thrown into disarray, coral reefs are overheated, withered by extreme temperatures and dissolving in acidified waters. Currents have been stable for millennia are starting to shift and change, inching toward collapse. In the far reaches of the North Atlantic and across broad swaths of the tropics, some climate tipping points may already be underway. Everything we talk about. And this is, and Jim Massa too, this is his area. Atlantic Ocean circulation, we talked about this, what, three, four weeks ago, mm-hmm. Jen? And this one there it is, the meridional overturning circulation acts as that conveyor belt. Mm-hmm. Early in the 2004 film, The Day After Tomorrow, climate scientist Jack Hall, played by a concerned-looking Dennis Quaid, receives a late-night phone call. It's a fellow scientist he'd recently met at a conference. You recall what you said in New Delhi about how polar melting might disrupt the North Atlantic current, the scientist asks. Well, the scientist continues, his voice trailing off, I think it's happening. What follows is hardly scientifically accurate. It's a Hollywood movie, after all. As a consequence of that disrupted current, though, tornadoes sweep across Los Angeles and the tsunami-like wave crashes into New York City. And didn't we just have a hurricane hit Southern California, right?
Yes.
We sure did. And a tsunami-like wave crashes into New York City. Well, but while most of the film belongs in the realm of sci-fi or cli-fi, climate fi, you know, the movie's central premise that the collapse of one ocean current could have knock-on effects for the rest of the world is true. The Atlantic Ocean is dominated by a single current, a thick band of water that flows north from the Gulf of Mexico, hugs the southeastern coast of the United States, and then shoots up north toward the frigid outposts of Greenland and Iceland. Along the coast of the U.S., where the current is known as the Gulf Stream, the water is warm. In the summer, it can reach a balmy 71 degrees Fahrenheit. But as it winds its way northward, it gets colder and colder, releasing huge amounts of heat into the atmosphere. This current, known as the Atlantic Meridional Overturning Circulation, or AMOC for short, keeps the weather mild in cities like Berlin, London, Paris. And scientists estimate that the energy it transports is roughly equivalent to power provided by 1 million average-sized nuke plants. Look at that. So this is pretty cool. The AMOC relies on a mechanism that happens off the coast of Greenland. So we see it going. In this graphic, there the waters of the current get so heavy, cold, and salty that they plunge to the ocean floor. But as the planet warms and the Arctic melts, billions of tons of fresh water are pouring into the ocean. The fresh water dilutes the current and makes it lighter and less likely to sink. In the short term, that means AMOC could slow down, and we say could. In the long run, it may grind to a halt completely. And we don't know what that long run is. And I just want to say, guys, Jason Box has some material if you want to look it up. I don't have it pulled up, but Greenland and the ice sheets and what they look like, there's trouble in Greenland. All right, so this is just not a theory, said Stefan Ramsdorf, climatologist at Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research in Germany. It has happened repeatedly in the history of the Earth during the last ice age. And again, I go back to the show that Jennifer and I did, and we had a clip of Stefan Ramsdorf talking about this. A collapsed Atlantic current could cause plummeting temperatures in the northern hemisphere, an extra foot and a half of sea level rise along the east coast of the U.S., and more ferocious winter storms over Europe, according to modeling from the U.K.'s Weather Service. Scientists say it could also rejigger agriculture by mutating precipitation patterns around the world, endangering crop yields in Great Britain and Ireland, which would become more arid and cold. While scientists know that the Atlantic current could shut down, nobody has a clear idea of when it could happen. In its 2014 summary of the state of the Earth's climate, the United Nations IPCC said it was very unlikely that it could collapse during the 21st century. Now, I'm going to veer off a little bit from this because there was newer research that's what we went over, Jennifer, that said they were talking about 2050, that there would be problems, more problems. Yes. So,
also to note, the Atlantic meridional circulation has already slowed. It's not like it could slow. It actually has slowed.
Right. That's why I think we're just going to go ahead over to coral reefs, because if you want to know and go back to our video a few weeks ago, we did this. And I do believe it's a little older article, but it's still extremely relevant to what we, you know, do here and what we want to accomplish. Jen, your turn.
Steph Gardner was nearing the end of her doctorate when the coral reefs she researched bleached for the first time. Her field sites were scattered along the Great Barrier Reef off the northeast coast of Australia, sections of the ocean that had begun to feel as familiar as her own hallways and her own home. She knew where the large Acropora coral was, with hundreds of pointy fronds. She knew how to make the right turn at a large lumpy pillar coral called a bomi. But this time something was amiss. A marine heat wave had surged across the Pacific Ocean, dialing the waters to 86 degrees Fahrenheit, the same temperature as a warm bath. Gardner's fellow researchers were coming up from the reef with tears in their eyes. The below coral had turned ghostly white, almost fluorescent white. It was just like seeing a graveyard. Absolutely gut-wrenching, says Gardner, who is now a researcher at the University of New South Wales in Sydney. That was 2016, the year of the largest and most devastating coral bleaching event in history. More than half of the corals in the northern 435-mile-long stretch of the Great Barrier Reef died, some immediately, cooking in temperatures 4 to 7 degrees Fahrenheit above average, others slowly starved, or over a period of months, and the bleaching wasn't confined to the coast of Australia. All over the world, reefs were turning white, dying off. Then, 2017, it happened again. Then again, in 2020. From my perspective, Gardner says, we've already reached a tipping point. Corals are strange creatures. Minuscule animals that house tiny friendly plants within their flesh and tentacles. In exchange, the plants help feed the coral, tinting their hosts with a dusky pink or brown. But when the water temperature rises above 1 to 2 degrees C, which is 1.8 to 3.6 degrees Fahrenheit, above average, that previously happy relationship breaks down. The plants rebel, spitting out toxic levels of oxygen. In response, the corals hastily jettison them, losing their color and standing out starkly bone white against the rest of the reef, a process known as bleaching. A reef can survive if cooler temperatures return quickly, returning the coral feeding plants to their homes. Without them, many corals starve to death, their skeletons swallowed up by thick tufts of what looks like dark green fur. The fur are colonizing species of algae which take over when corals crumble. Mm. What was once a living, vibrant reef becomes a reef of skeletons, said David Klein, a coral scientist from Smithsonian Tropical Research Institute in Panama. It becomes a morgue, covered over with slimy algae. It's hard to identify a single global tipping point for corals. Each reef is different, accustomed to different temperatures and living with different sources of stress. One reef exposed to record high temperatures might die in a matter of weeks, already overwhelmed by an influx of smothering algae. Another might survive, protected by cold water welling up from the ocean floor. But as the planet warms, the ocean warms with it, and eventually most of the coral reefs will pay the price. A healthy reef can take on 10 to 15 years to return to normal after a catastrophic heat wave, but severe bleaching is now occurring every 6 years.
And now.
According to, now it's happening again.
That's in Florida. Right. Yeah, they're done.
I mean, it was 101 degrees on the tip of Florida. No reef can survive that.
Unreal, Jennifer.
I know. It's so sad. According to the IPCC, 70 to 90% of coral reefs could disappear even if average temperatures remain under 1.5 degrees, which is 2.7 degrees Fahrenheit of global warming. At 2 degrees of warming, nearly all of them, 99%, would vanish. That's not just rising temperatures that threatens reefs. The ocean absorbs more than a quarter of the carbon dioxide that humans spew into the atmosphere. And all that gas makes the water sharply acidic. The pH of a reef drops too low, its corals won't just be overwhelmed by heat, their skeletons could start dissolving. Mm. This guy is Ove Ho Goodberg. Okay, Ove Ho Goodberg, a professor of marine studies at Australia's University of Queensland, says current rates of warming could soon make the planets inhospitable for reefs. I believe you get to a point where the odds are just so stacked, and the corals are so sick, and poor, we're just not going to have coral reefs anymore. That could be catastrophic for the millions of people who depend on reefs around the world. Despite covering less than 2% of the ocean floor, corals' complex structures house around a quarter of the planet's marine species. They also provide food, income, and storm protection for about 500 million people. Wow. Despite the odds, scientists are continuing to help reefs recover any way they can, engaging in a Noah's Ark type of attempt to rescue and reintroduce as many corals as possible. Some are crossbreeding corals, trying to develop species that can withstand record high temperatures and acidity. Others are visiting distant coral outposts like hot mangrove lagoons to better understand how so-called super corals are already surviving some of the most challenging conditions in the world. Quote, "We've shifted into an emergency mindset," Klein says. "If we don't actively try and protect coral reefs, things are going to get really, they're really going to change for the worse." And this next one is ice. Do you want to?
They're going to change. We need a little sound.
Yeah.
Okay. Ice. Get out of there. Ice. which we both love, ice. Okay, this is the Beaufort Sea. And the Greenland ice sheet in the high Arctic and the Antarctic ice sheet that encircles the South Pole combine to hold 99% of the world's fresh water. If all of that water emptied into the sea, the oceans would rise hundreds of feet, permanently redrawing Earth's coastlines. A growing body of evidence from Earth's geologic past shows that both ice sheets can melt rapidly when something or someone fiddles with the thermostat. Both appear to have tipping points that could lead to runaway ice collapse and irreversible sea level rise. But reaching those thresholds varies dramatically from one pole to the other as a result of stark differences in the atmosphere and ocean currents surrounding each pole, as well as the geometry of and scale of the two ice sheets. Both ice sheets are effectively a vast mountain of ice draped over a continent like Antarctica or a giant island like Greenland. Ice flows off these frozen mountains into the surrounding seas through hundreds of enormous frozen rivers known as outlet glaciers. In parts of Greenland where outlet glaciers meet the ocean, the water is warm enough that these glaciers immediately start to melt and break up. But in much colder seas surrounding Antarctica, they're often buttressed by floating shelves, which we talked about, was that last week, Jennifer?
It could have been last week.
Like corks and champagne bottles, these shelves help hold back that land ice behind them unless warming water starts to shake shelves loose.
Wow.
Yeah, look at that's Greenland. It was early one May when Santiago La Peña realized something was not right. The glaciologist had just hiked the Russell Glacier, located about 20 miles inland of Greenland's west coast. At that time of year, the glacier should have been frozen solid, but a river of meltwater had formed across its surface, creating a series of enormous waterfalls. A landscape that should have been silent was reverberating with the roar of freshly melted ice. And I just happen to have that one. That was just amazing. He said it was a record year for the loss of Greenland's ice. After an unusually warm spring followed by a late July heat wave, that caused nearly the entire sheet surface to start melting. Greenland would go on to shed 532 billion tons of ice into the sea that year. As a result, global sea levels are now permanently 1.5 millimeters or 0.06 inches higher. Seems like a little, but it all cumulatively measures up. A total meltdown of Greenland's ice sheet would raise sea levels much higher still, by about 24 feet, though scientists estimate that it could take at least 1,000 years for Earth's second largest ice sheet to melt completely. Years like 2019 are a reminder that Greenland is already undergoing a massive transformation with planet-wide consequences. Between 1992 and 2018, Greenland shed nearly 4 trillion tons of ice, and researchers worry that if carbon emissions continue to rise, it could pass a point of no return in decades. There are two key phenomena behind Greenland's melting, and if they accelerate and if future feedback loops amplify them, the ice sheet could plunge into a state of irreversible loss. Now, guys, we've seen a lot more in just a few years since this came out. We've seen a lot more. So one of these is a mild summer weather and a warming atmosphere melting the sheet's surface, causing water to pool and run downhill into the sea. The thawing of fresh white snowfall exposes darker bare ice, which absorbs more of the sun's energy, triggering more melting. The other is around Greenland's coasts, where rising ocean temperatures are destabilizing the edges of the glaciers that funnel ice into the ocean. As these gateways break up, the frozen rivers, they hold back, start flowing faster into the surrounding area. Aww. Over the last 30 years, heat in the ocean and in the atmosphere has contributed roughly equally to Greenland's slim down. But in recent years, the atmosphere has taken a larger role as summertime heat waves, supercharged by climate change, global warming, trigger melt events like Greenland saw in 2012 and 2019. If those become the norm, dangerous feedback loops could kick in. One that's particularly troubling is as Greenland's surface melts, the ice sheet's elevation drops like a popsicle, flattening onto a pavement. And as surface elevation falls, surface air temperatures, they rise, resulting in more melting. So taken together, all of these processes could tip the ice sheet into a state of irreversible meltdown. Now, I'm not going to go into the study because there's newer studies. So we just want to go over, unless we figure out a way to rapidly reverse climate forcing, my opinion is that the ice sheet is doomed. So that's nice, right? Says Ian Howitt, a glaciologist at Ohio State University. Howitt co-authored last year, which I don't know which year exactly that was, study that suggests Greenland already passed a mini tipping point in the early 2000s when dozens of coastal glaciers simultaneously started to retreat. So they're going on and they're talking about lowering emissions and all that, but moved down to even in a catastrophic meltdown scenario, we have to remember it's going to take a long time to lose it, said Ruth Mottram, a climate scientist and glaciologist at the Danish Meteorological Institute. And how long exactly that process takes depends on our emissions. So it really is about emissions for melting. It looks very different if we lose all of Greenland ice sheet in the next 1,000 years versus if we lose it all in the next 10 or 20, says Twyla Moon, a glaciologist at the National Snow and Ice Data Center. We can decide we don't want to lose as much ice as quickly. A few years ago, maybe that felt that way, but listen to Jason Box, Jennifer, right now, what he talks about.
Yeah. You want me to take Antarctica?
I want you to take Antarctica.
All right, guys, we're diving down to Antarctica. Ted Scambos, who has studied Antarctica for decades, but in December 2019, he saw the ice sheet's future with his own eyes. He had just arrived at the remote shores of West Antarctica's Amundsen Sea, and his team had set up a field camp on the floating ice shelf that holds back the Thwaites Glacier. Looking inland and uphill at the vast frozen river that wends its way up into the heart of West Antarctica, Scambos could see giant icy crevasses stretching across the horizon like cracks in a wall on the brink of collapse. The sense of scale of this huge region pushing towards the sea actually gives one a feeling of unease, recalls Scambos, a glaciologist at University of Colorado, Boulder. You can feel the threat live and in person. Since the early 2000s, Thwaites, also known as the Doomsday Glacier, has dumped a trillion tons of ice into the sea. Scientists like Scambos believe it may be in the early stages of irreversible collapse, which could take out a large portion of West Antarctic ice sheet, raising global sea levels by at least 2 feet, and perhaps more than 10. A race is now on to determine whether Thwaites has already crossed such a tipping point, and whether some of the larger coastal glaciers rimming East Antarctica will be similarly imperiled. Global warming continues unabated. And here's Thwaites glacier graphic. The reason Thwaites is particularly unstable has to do with its shape. The bottom of the glacier is anchored to an ancient seabed, a point called the grounding line, where rock, ice, and ocean meet. As one moves inland on Thwaites, the bedrock below it gets deeper. Warm ocean water is weakening the underside of the floating ice shelves that support Thwaites. That, in turn, pushes the grounding line inland, leaving progressively thicker slabs of ice floating unmoored. Wow. The edges of the shelf have a hard time holding back thicker floating ice, so the entire glacier starts flowing faster into the sea. This triggers even more retreat in a runaway process known as marine ice sheet instability. According to Scambos, that runaway situation may already be started at Thwaites. He adds that there are only one or two regions left where the bedrock rises and could potentially stabilize the glacier as it retreats inland. The warm water that's causing so much trouble for Thwaites is a part of the deep salty ring that encircles the continent. Today, a recent strengthening of the westerly winds that whip around Antarctica is pushing more of this warm water towards Thwaites, where it can attack the underside of the glacier. Even if we were to shut down all carbon emissions today, it's unlikely that we could completely shut off the process causing Thwaites to retreat. It's just going to be a component of how the Earth works for the foreseeable future, Scambos says, meaning millennia. But not everyone is convinced that Thwaites is doomed. I don't think we know enough to say that we have reached a tipping point, says Indrani Das, a glaciologist at Columbia University. Our observation period is not long enough to assess irreversibility. What's more, even if a runaway scenario is underway, we can still slow it down by slashing emissions rapidly. Oh God, hope springs eternal. Wonderful. Scambos notes that avoiding more than 2 degrees C of global warming could make a big difference. It is still runaway, but it's much slower. So degrees of runaway, right? Yeah. Well, glaciologists have suspected for decades that Thwaites and the surrounding West Antarctic ice sheet are in a precarious position. East Antarctica's much larger and colder mantle of ice was long considered stable, at least by comparison. East Antarctica holds enough frozen water to lift the sea levels by 170 feet. Compared with West Antarctica's 16 feet. But over the past decade, the assumption that most of the ice will remain put has begun to fade, according to Hawat, the Ohio State University glaciologist. Improved maps of the continent have revealed that large portions of East Antarctica, including major sections of ice contained inside Totten and Denham glaciers and the Wilkes Basin, are also anchored on deep reverse sloping bedrock that may be prone to marine ice sheet instability. While East Antarctica's deep-rooted glaciers seem to be further away from reaching the tipping point for now, as Scambos puts it, continued ocean warming and circulation of warm, deep water beneath their protective ice shelves could eventually destabilize them. 2000 modeling paper found that removing a comparably small plug of ice from the shelf buttressing the Wilkes Basin, equivalent to just 3 inches of sea level rise, could be enough to tip off runaway collapse that adds up to 13 feet global sea level rise. Recent airborne and satellite remote sensing surveys, meanwhile, reveal that both Totten and Denman glaciers are already retreating at their grounding lines. The collapse of Totten would add the equivalent of another 13 feet of sea level rise, and Denman would add another 5. You start to put all that together, Sandy, you're talking about real big numbers, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
This accounts for a lot more sea level potential than West Antarctica, said Helen Fricker, a glaciologist at the Scripps Institution of Oceanography in San Diego, California. So our next section is land, Sandy. Do you want to take
it? Ooh, the land. Yes, I love land. Land is gold. And I'll start by saying it's a holiday weekend where I live, and all the cityites are down here on their land shooting guns, fireworks. It's going to be a weekend of me getting pissed off. I can tell you right now. I you know, it just angers me, but what are you going to do? They come down to their little, you know, weekend getaways. All right. So, land. As we go about our daily lives, the carbon-rich soils of the boreal forest and lush rainforests of the tropics are hard at work at sucking up carbon dioxide, forming what are known as terrestrial carbon sinks. And as a result, every year, land-based ecosystems absorb more CO2 than they emit. From 2007 to 17, they removed about a third of total anthropogenic emissions from the atmosphere. That's cool. But three potential tipping points in the terrestrial system, one in the Arctic, one in the subarctic, and another near the equator, could force the release of huge amounts of carbon stored within these sinks. Once those thresholds are passed, feedback loops might start spiraling, accelerating climate change and reshaping our planet's forests and soils. So first is the permafrost, which, who is our permafrost queen of the show? Miss Jennifer.
Permamush.
Yes. Jennifer's the queen of permamush. We need to get her a sash that says Miss Permamush. Absolutely. Right? I would be silly enough to do that, Jen. In 2019, for Halloween, Brendan Rogers stumbled into an open wound of our warming planet. He was doing ecological field work in the Alaskan tundra during a summer so hot that he recalls people walking around in shorts and t-shirts. And he was about to set up a piece of equipment. The ground beneath him gave way, sending him falling into an empty crater. That's got to be really scary. Rogers had just walked into what scientists call a thermokarst feature. And we've talked about those in shows.
That's right.
Their land. I told you this article like encapsulates a lot of what we talked about.
Everything we've been talking about for years.
Yes, Rogers had just walked into what scientists call a thermokarst. Okay, so their landscape slides features all over the permafrost zone where the ground just literally collapses, formed by rapid melt. They are fingerprints of a process taking place throughout the Arctic, permafrost thaw. Permamush is an ancient Arctic soil that usually stays frozen year-round, hence the perma. So there's what it looks like. Permafrost stores almost twice the amount of carbon than is currently in the atmosphere.
That's scary right there.
Right there. There's
twice as much as is already in the atmosphere.
Yeah, okay. Absolutely. And these icy soils act a bit like a freezer, and slowing the decomposition of dead plants, animals, and microbes. As the Arctic warms and permafrost soils thaw, the decomposition speeds up, releasing CO2 and methane, a greenhouse gas that is 84 times as potent as carbon dioxide in the short term. Right. And we talked about methane also, you know, last week. Historically, vast stores of permafrost in the northern Arctic regions of Alaska, Siberia, Canada, and Greenland have contributed to the Earth's carbon sink, taking in more carbon than they emit every year thanks to the growth of carbon-eating lichens and mosses on the surface. But the effects of thaw might have already flipped the permafrost region from a carbon sink to a source. An international team of scientists estimated that during each winter from 2003 to 17, Arctic permafrost regions lost 1.7 billion metric tons of carbon, while only storing an average of 1 billion metric tons of carbon each summer. The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration's Arctic Report Card for 2019 found that the permafrost region had already started to lose more carbon than it captures, causing a net 300 to 600 million metric tons of carbon to be released into the atmosphere every year. Isn't that nice?
That was 4 years ago, right?
Yeah. So yeah.
It was basically runaway 4 years ago. Imagine what it is now.
Let me say goodnight, Veg. Vegematic is leaving. Thank you. We love you. Don't forget to go to the Vegematic channel. Okay. And subscribe. So, yes, Exactly, Jennifer. This is a bit older, but it's still relevant, except just look at the data that's updated in 4 years and you can see the changes in a very short time. Unbelievably so. So over the next 300 years, worst case scenario models predict that 208 billion metric tons of carbon could be released through gradual permafrost thaw, about 15% of what is currently stored. But it could take place abruptly. Sudden thaw on features like lakes, wetlands, and hills, which produce formations like the crater Rogers fell into, might lead to an additional 60 to 100 billion metric tons of CO2 emissions. That doesn't take into account more intense wildfires, which we saw again this year, the terrible ones that are still going on in Canada, which combust the carbon stored in permafrost soils and accelerate thaw. And Jennifer, were there forest fires this year in Siberia too?
Oh, yeah, so. Every single year. They never really go out. They just keep going.
Yeah.
They go underground and then come up again.
Right. That's right. And so they feed into an accelerating feedback loop, triggering more warming and more permafrost loss. So one reason the loss of so much permafrost is so concerning to scientists is that it's irreversible. The carbon buried across the Arctic tundra took millennia to accumulate. Once it's gone, Lenton says, there's no getting it back. And there's the boreal forest. Boreal
forest. In the summer of 2014, the normally bright midday suns of Canada's Northwest Territories turned pitch black. After blood red sun and weeks of thick smoke, Jennifer Balser watched as ash rained down over the little town of Yellowknife, where she lived and worked researching boreal forest ecosystems, a band of coniferous forest that circles the globe right below the Arctic. Mm-hmm. That year hosted a particularly devastating wildfire season. The one road to Yellowknife was closed for 3 weeks, with no food coming in or out. For days, a huge cloud of smoke hung across the lake near where her family lived. As Balser watched the forest burn from her home, with her kids sheltered inside, she was aware she was living in a region that is being reshaped by climate change. Quote, the air quality was so bad, we couldn't take the kids outside, she recalls. It was really hard to be outside. You actually felt physically ill. The boreal forest spans 1.5 billion acres around the planet, more than half the area of Europe, spread across northern Russia and Canada. It is also the largest carbon storage reservoir on land, containing 30 to 40% of all carbon sequestered on land, and takes up slightly more carbon than it emits every year. Some of this carbon is kept above ground in the trees, but a chunk is invisible to the naked eye. About 85% of it is locked away in cold, wet soils. Over time, moss and slowly decomposing vegetation forms layers of carbon-rich soil known as peat. In some regions where it's cold enough, the peat is largely permafrost. But the boreal forests are changing. Fire is part of the natural rhythm of boreal forests, and many tree species within them are adapted to it. But as conditions become warmer and drier, wildfires are happening more frequently and burning over greater areas, threatening the vast reserve of carbon stored in the soil of the boreal region and potentially transforming the forest into grassland or tundra. The 2014 wildfires of Northwest Territories that Balser lived through burned 8.6 million acres of boreal forest that season alone, compared to the usual average of 1.5 million acres, releasing 94 million metric tons of CO2.
Wow.
The trend has only continued. The summer of 2020 was a record year for wildfires in Siberia, with 26.9 million acres of forest torched as temperatures reached over 100 degrees Fahrenheit in parts of the Arctic. Mm. As wildfires accelerate, researchers fear the carbon emissions from the fires could threaten the region's ability to store more carbon than it emits, and eventually flip it from a source of carbon emissions to a source of carbon emissions. Mm-hmm. The winter following the 2014 blazes, some fires were still smoldering in the soil, and Balzer could see them popping up occasionally through the snow, a phenomenon known as zombie fires. Her team studied the impacts that wildfire season on carbon that had previously accumulated in the soils known as legacy carbon. It found that the 2014 wildfire burned older and deeper carbon reserves, releasing them into the atmosphere. That's one part of how the tipping points work in the boreal forest. As the climate warms, wildfires intensify, releasing more carbon, further accelerating warming, Balzer explains. That's not the only feedback at play. As fires return more frequently, forests might fail to recover and slowly morph into grassland or tundra, reducing the amount of carbon stored above ground. And as warming lures pests like bark beetles northward, it also threatens the well-being of forests and the release of carbon stored within them, another potential reinforcing loop. There are other feedbacks, however, that could help stabilize the system. Study charting the regrowth of Alaskan forests following wildfires found that tree species in the region shifted from black spruce to deciduous trees, allowing the regenerated forest to store even more carbon than the old versions. Mm. That transition could mean that over time, the carbon impacts of forest fires could be less severe than previously believed. Balzer says that similar transitions after fire could be taking place across North America boreal region. These findings, she explains, point to the broader resilience of that particular function of the system. Understanding how these different feedbacks might shape the future of the boreal forest and its vast reserves of carbon is a massive scientific undertaking. Scott Goetz, the leader of NASA's Arctic Boreal Vulnerability Experiment, a group of scientists keeping tabs on the vital signs of the region, monitoring, among other things, shifts in how the forests are storing and releasing carbon. His team uses field measurements, data from aircraft flown over the forest, and satellites to paint a picture of how much carbon boreal forests take up and release every year. Those measurements then inform models of the region's future. Goetz says that in many ways, the multiple feedbacks at play make predicting what will happen a hellishly complicated problem. Because of this, Goetz says he doesn't have a clear answer about if and when and how fast a system could cross tipping threshold. I don't think we actually know. And then we have the Amazon rainforest, Sandy.
All right. David LaPola, he's worked in the Amazon for many years, but September of 2015 sticks out in his memory. He was teaching a field course at a research station 40 miles north of Manaus in the center of the Amazon basin. That month was extremely hot and dry, and LaPola noticed how it had sucked the moisture out of the forest. He recalls that the top 20 inches or so of the soil was bone dry. And this was in central Amazon, the world's largest rainforest, which normally gets 10 feet of rain every year. I've never seen it like that before, neither before nor later on, LaPola said. I remember seedlings drying out and dying, small saplings getting drier, and the leaves browning. LaPola was witnessing firsthand the impacts of a devastating El Nino, Now, that was that one back then. A naturally occurring climate pattern worsened by global warming. That year brought unusually dry and hot conditions to the Amazon. El Nino-fueled droughts kill trees and suppress growth across the Amazon. God, we're going to have this again. I hope it's not, like, bad, bad. Dead trees then release the carbon stored within them, and decreased tree growth means less carbon stored across the system as a whole. The result, the 2015 El Nino drought temporarily turned rainforests from carbon sinks into carbon sources. Adding about 2.5 billion tons of carbon to the atmosphere. That could be a preview of what's to come. The Amazon rainforest, commonly known as the lungs of the world, holds an estimated 150 to 200 billion metric tons of carbon in its vast reserves of tree and plant mass. Historically, it has represented around a quarter of the world's terrestrial carbon sink. But the Amazon, like so many other places on Earth, is getting hotter and drier. Over the past century, the temperature in the region has risen by 1 to 1.5 degrees. See, and in some places the dry season has lengthened 4 to nearly 5 months. Look at that. See, they're cutting down those trees. Well, hopefully Lula stops some of that. President Lula. All of this has affected what Lapola calls tree demography. How long trees live, their mortality rates, and growth rates of new trees, though higher levels of CO2 in the atmosphere have caused tropical trees to take up more of the greenhouse gas through photosynthesis, an effect known as carbon fertilization. The Amazon carbon sink declined by a third from 2005 to 15 when compared to the 1990s, mostly as a result of increased tree mortality, and a fifth now acts as a carbon source. So some models predict that the Amazon will become a permanent source of carbon emissions by 2035, further contributing to climate change. And then I'm gonna speed it up, and I'm gonna talk about, because we know the cattle ranchers and the farmers cutting down all the trees. I just want to mention currently Ecuador has said that they will not do that anymore. Ecuador's protecting their part of the Amazon. So that's updated information. Mm-hmm. And so they have been doing a lot of studying on this. But he said, Lepola said, in the Amazon, deforestation comes together with global climate and threatens to push the region past a dangerous tipping point, a risk not just for the health of the rainforest, but for the whole planet. And that's why I say what Ecuador has done is, you know, nothing short of phenomenal. People are recognizing that things have to be done. Like, here, what can we do? Well, I don't know. Do we want to go into, I mean, of course, mm-hmm. there's, we should. You want to read this?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
So this is the last section. I don't know if it's viable. You guys decide, but it's called What Can We Do? As coral reefs dissolve, Antarctica melts, and vast swaths of rainforest disappear, the world already seems to be headed down a dark path. 2 or 3 degrees C of warming, land, sea, and ice fundamentally transformed, and the consequences of playing out on the coastlines and in city neighborhoods thousands of miles away. But Jacqueline Gill, University of Maine paleoclimatologist, does worry that too much focus on tipping points could backfire. It's a sentiment echoed by the glaciologist Twyla Moon. Tipping points are so scary that they could feed into a narrative of hopelessness. We may not be able to predict exactly when some of these tipping points occur, but what we can do is control our actions, take ownership for our emissions. And there are reasons for optimism. We'll see. A few researchers have begun to study another set of tipping points, a group that, instead of spiraling the planet into increasing dangerous state, could help shift it back into balance. These so-called social tipping points follow the same basic principle as their counterparts in the natural world. First, change happened slowly, then all at once. 1907, 140,000 Americans had registered automobiles. Others had got around cities by horse-drawn vehicles, bicycles, and trolley cars. Mm-hmm. By 1917, 10 years later, however, thanks to plummeting prices for automobiles, there were almost 5 million cars on American roads. More recent example, by 2003, no state in the country legally recognized gay marriage. 12 years later, after a dramatic shift in public opinion and a ruling by the Supreme Court, same-sex marriage was legal in all 50.
That won't be for long.
So they're trying hard. They're kind of grasping at straws.
They are.
Fast change can happen, said Iona Otto, a researcher at the Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research in Germany. Otto and 13 other scientists released a paper last year arguing that several such social tipping points could drive rapid increase in initiatives aimed at cutting carbon dioxide emissions. Some of them are concrete and obvious. A drop in renewable energy prices, for example, such as solar and wind, are cheaper than fossil fuels. Others are more abstract, like a shift in public attitudes towards seeing fossil fuels as fundamentally immoral. Most social tipping points are hard to measure and even harder to predict, but there are signs that they may be slowly approaching. In 2009, a solar farm cost 223% more than a new coal plant. Today, those numbers have roughly flipped. That means that one of Otto and her colleagues' key thresholds is within reach. In many regions, renewables are now a cheaper source of energy than fossil fuels. At the same time, the movement to divest university endowments from fossil fuels, combined with high-profile climate protests by Swedish activist Greta Thunberg and organizing by other young people, has already contributed to a growing sense, especially among the younger millennials and Generation Z, that fossil fuel use is unethical. Some people have begun avoid flying due to flag scam or flight shame. Over the airline's sky-high industry carbon footprint, even oil and gas giants now feel the need to advertise their promise to bring their emissions to zero by 2050. In the U.S., youth activism sparked a conversation, then a movement, around the idea of clean energy-focused Green New Deal. It's hard to say whether these trends will continue, but they provide reason to hope that we'll hit these more virtuous tipping points before catastrophic ones. Boy, are they reaching. Hopefully, these tipping points will start to accumulate and then come together as an avalanche. Boy, okay, all I have to say, Sandy, is this whole last section called What Can We Do is not, I mean, it's all
I,
like
I have the
bargaining and, you know, all that stuff.
Well, yeah. And that's going to happen. I mean, you know, when I interviewed Margaret Klein Solomon, I mean, she's 36 years old. These are people that are going to try and do whatever they can. And I have, I don't know if this person's still here, but, you know, he's always, always doing this to me. So I'm going to put it up. Jennifer and Sandy, if we are at a point of no return, then the actions of Margaret Klein Solomon and the climate emergency movement is a colossal waste of time. Do you agree? No, it's absolutely not. And you're always, Jaya Curve loves to do this. Nothing's a waste of time. Nothing. And if we give up fossil fuels, it's not a waste of time, is it? No. It's absolutely not. It's just something that we see how serious everything is. And it's hard to, you know, it's just hard to, I don't know. What can I say? We're living in really difficult times. That's all.
We are.
But you know what I'm going to do, Jen? I'm going to give it to you because since we are living in difficult times,
Yeah. And I think we're going to have to save the worms once again, Sandy, for next week.
Yeah, I think
We keep talking about the worms.
I know, the ancient worms, but Jennifer wants to introduce you to somebody.
Yeah, so I just wanted to give a shout out to a guy named Peter Russell, R-U-S-S-E-L-L, and he has just written a long essay that I've just finished listening to. You can get it on Audible, called Forgiving Humanity: How the Most Innovative Species Became the Most Dangerous, The Curse of Exponential Change. And I'm just going to read this little blurb, and, it reminds me of somebody who's really starting to contend with this. You know, mm-hmm. I feel like I've been there, sort of like, but mm-hmm. it's a really good read. Okay, why has the most innovative species become the most dangerous? The answer, suggests Peter Russell, lies in humanity's ever-accelerating pace of development. He shows how innovation breeds further innovation, fueling a positive feedback loop that leads to exponential rates of growth. But our minds struggle to comprehend the full implications of exponential growth, leaving us with a blind spot for the future. However fast the pace of change may seem today, it will be much faster in the years to come, bringing ever more rapid scientific and technological advances. But with this rapid progress comes unexpected consequence: the faster the pace of change, the greater the stress on our personal, social, and planetary systems. And the greater the stress, the more likely is systemic breakdown. Russell concludes that we are heading into a future with technology beyond our dreams, but in a world that's breaking at the seams. Oh, that mm-hmm. kind of rhymes. It's like a little poem. Very nice. This doesn't mean humankind has taken the wrong turn. I will see. Spiraling rates of development with all their consequences, positive and negative, are the inevitable destiny of any intelligent, technologically empowered species. How do we adapt to an ever-increasing pace of life? How do we prepare for a future that's becoming more and more unpredictable? What does it mean for humanity and our place in the cosmos? So it's a good kind of think read, you know?
He also has these really weird videos. he's actually using AI to create himself. And
he cloned himself in his video. It's kind of interesting.
You have to watch it. It's creepy and weird, but he did it. And you might as well. All right. So we've done a pretty comprehensive show. And I want to tell you guys, I do have a closing little video that we are going to play to leave, because it's really cute, and it does it just closes the show in a sweet way. And I just want to say thank you to people in the chat, by the way. It's a good chat. And Solar Tony, I just wanted to put up his comment: it's possible to halt it. Consider that 20 nations out of 200 are the culprit. 20 nations use 80% of global resources: air, water, soil, plant, SUVs, oil, cars, metals, anything. He's right. And Solar Tony does his own thing, so I could put a link to what he does, and his he does trainings, and anyway. So other than that, we're going to end. So, Jen, would you like to?
It was a good retrospective, Sandy. Thank you for picking this article from Gris, The 7 Climate Tipping Points That Could Change the World Forever. I don't think it's a question of if. I think it's all really a question of when. Do we have a chance to turn back the clock and make a more beautiful Earth as it was? I would say not a snowball's chance in hell. But at the same time, does it make trying wrong? No, it doesn't. You know, we're at a big time of change and reckoning, and that reckoning is going to affect each and every one of us a little bit differently. So Good luck, everyone.
Very well said. So, guys, enjoy the closing video. Oh, flush of the day. Jennifer Pickett, while I play, and I'll play it. Just tell me what out of everything, or we can ask the chat, out of everything you guys heard, what was the flush of the day? Let me get the chat and I'll see. Okay. What's the point of no return flush? Or should we just say?
I would say the whole thing, because all the tipping points are linked together. And
right.
As it said, as the world warms, these Earth systems are changing. Could further warming make them spiral out of control? Yes, definitely further warming is going
to flush the tipping points. All right. We flushed the tipping points. There you go. Alrighty, now I'm happy because we didn't leave out the flush. Alright, so stay for the last video. It's really cute, I promise you. Give me a second, I'll put it up. Good night, everybody. We love you.